Well, good afternoon, everybody. It's a privilege to be here speaking to such an esteemed audience of both colleagues and students. And thank you so much, Julia, for inviting me to give a presentation in this slot. For those of you unfamiliar with the work, I hope that this will inspire, perhaps invite you to ask some questions, explore the subtle energy paradigm in relation to agriculture. For those of you already in the field, I'm sure that I'll be covering familiar material, and hopefully that will be reassuring and familiar to you to hear a colleague in the field sharing work that might well be your own. So this would be a comment first, just to make as a general, that universal mind includes everything. We can choose where to place our attention. And part of the shamanic practice, part of the geobiology practice, part of truly working with a quantum field, which is an interactive field, an interactive intelligent field, is that we want to be very careful about what we put in our mind. How many of you put organic food in your bodies as a preference? How many of you put unfiltered media in your heads? Which do you think is more important? What do you think, is it more important what you put in your mind, or is it more important what you put in your body?
The mind is
the body. Maybe the body is an expression of manifest. I'll leave that thought with you. There aren't any answers in this presentation. There are only provocative questions. All right. I would recommend you be extremely scrupulous about what you allow to be put into your mind, and even more so what you choose to hold in your mind as a belief, and even beyond that, what you choose to express from your mind into the world. This has immeasurable consequence. So, presentation here. That's gone a bit dim, isn't it? Is that visible still? Seems brighter on my screen. That seems as bright as we'll get. So, the presentation overall, we're going to look at subtle energies in landscape and how this affects agricultural systems. And I want to just make a comment first that we've had 6,500 years of sustainable agriculture, and we've had 100 years of chemistry which has sterilized and degraded our soils to the point of soil loss and semi-aridity across the globe that is now truly threatening the sustainability of our species on the planet. And one of the shifts that's happened is that husbandry has been recategorized as agricultural science, and so the relationship has been taken out of it. And so what we need to be extremely aware of is a consequence of relationship. Now, we spend a lot of time studying relationship between people and each other, and all of the same paradigm, all of the same parameters apply when we engage in relationship with place, in relationship with plant, in relationship with animal. And we find that the same parameters of relationship are critically present in both of those. Now, there is a Newtonian belief that landscape is inanimate, and that plants and animals have limited sentience. This is not our experience in the field. And when we're looking at subtle energies in landscape, what we're really talking about is the communication between ourselves and the landscape, between ourselves and the sentient intelligence of our environment. Now, part of the issue of discussing this is what we categorize and believe to be intelligence. We have a global intelligence that includes our physical intelligence, our biological intelligence, the intelligence of our bones and our teeth, the patting intelligence. There is one layer of multiple intelligences that is rational, self-reflective, cognitive thought. In terms of bandwidth, as you'll know from neuroscience, that's one of the most limited and narrow layers of intelligence that we have, and it's rarely able to problem solve on its own. So when we're talking about intelligence, we're talking about global intelligence. We're including the intelligence of bones and teeth, of pattern. We're including the intelligence of biology. We're including the intelligence of organic systems. We're not limiting our definition of intelligence to beta range human cognitive rational linear thinking. That's a very, very small piece of consciousness. It's a piece that we've become infatuated with and that we try and solve all other problems with, even though they're not necessarily accessible to that pattern of thinking. So we're talking about communication and dialogue, and within that, and particularly not only as an introduction, but this is a point that I want to make to colleagues, because I'm assuming that this is going to be something that's shared amongst collegial experience, and it's something that I feel is extremely important in this regard when we're using subtle energies, is that as a priority and first, when we're doing quantum agriculture, when we're doing land whispering or fairy whispering or elf whispering or gnome whispering or however you choose to categorize this, the first thing that has to happen is the healing of hurts from landscape. Now, landscape carries trauma. How many of you have experienced the feel of an old battlefield site? How many of you felt the atmosphere left over from road traffic accident, or from rape, or from suicide, or from murder, or from massacre? Also, how many of you have experienced similar landscape stress and trauma from the new motorway, or from the quarry, or the mine? And so there are ways, both in terms of place memory of human emotions getting imprinted into landscape, and also physical distress and trauma through pattern interference, just the same as breaking our bones. When we quarry and mine, we disrupt an ancient pattern in the landscape that includes energy flow through it. And if you've got a hangover, you're probably not going to be in the best position to show up and get good communication in your dialogue the next morning. We don't expect high productive exchange to occur if one or both parties are distressed. And I have observed that many subtle energy techniques fail to work when applied into a landscape that is not healthy energetically. If you're trying to fairy whisper on a battlefield site, they can't hear you. They're just too busy with their own stress and preoccupied with the saturation of negative emotions. This may be from indigenous displacement, it may be curses, it may be, as we've mentioned, physical or emotional trauma. So for quantum agriculture to work successfully, in my observation, and therefore I've come to this conclusion, is that we must first apply healing techniques to our landscape. And that is very much the realm of the geobiologist. It's quite straightforward work to do. It's very joyous and productive work to do. There are training programs, there are people that you can study with, but this really needs to happen first. And if we don't do this, we're going to be very disappointed with our homeopathy, with our elf whispering, with our radionics, because they won't have an impact on a system that is already too stressed to respond to that very gentle whispering stimulus. So first, when we approach a landscape, we bring our healing attention to it in whatever way we do. And just to say for those of you who are here, any system of holistic healing that works on a person will also work on an animal, will also work on a plant, and will also work on landscape. So we don't need to learn special techniques of how to heal landscape. Our loving attention will get 90% of the work done. And then any technique or protocol that we have that will work in a person, we can adapt to scale both of mass and of historical time in order to bring a landscape further into peace. Also to say that this is a sliding scale. The healthier your landscape is, the more interactive it can be. We don't necessarily need to wait for 100% before we can have our first communication. So once we've done that, then we can move on to really the dialogue, which is the patterning of current use. And what I want to share with you is, for an elemental consciousness, looking at the mind of a person, particularly the mind of a person in beta consciousness, it's like being a diver underwater, seeing the shadow of a boat on the surface. They can see that we're here, but they can't read our purpose. Is it a fishing boat? Is it a warship? Is it a lilo? Is it kids out for a party? They can't tell unless we bring our mind to their level of consciousness. Now, we can do that easily because that level of consciousness is already integrated in us. We are built of the same stuff as the Earth is. We're built from stardust. We're built from earth, air, fire, and water. So we are an encapsulated form of our landscape. So this is an integrated intelligence and level of consciousness that we already have. As I say, it's not your beta rational consciousness. If you want to speak to a landscape, you need to meet it at the level of consciousness that it's at. And if we look at our beta, alpha, and theta, and delta consciousness, what we find is that you can measure woody plants up to 24 cycles per second, which is already into our low beta. Our high beta goes 36 cycles per second. So when we're talking about communication, we're talking about waveform generated and interacted from the mind with plants, and we can measure easily alpha and theta consciousness in plants lower down for elementals. So this is within our frequency range, but we need to meet them at their own consciousness. Same as working with your kids, same as working with your companion animals. You meet them where they are and establish rapport, and then a dialogue, whether that's telepathic or communicated in some other fashion, can occur. So the passion in current use. And then beyond that, there are optimizations, which are the rocket fuel that makes things go faster. Often the distraction and the disappointment that happens when people get into this field is that they don't do number one, and they don't really do number two, and they go straight to number three. Mm-hmm. And if you go straight to number three, if you're just trying to apply non-toxic, holistic, go-faster techniques, you really haven't shifted out of the pharmacological model. You really haven't shifted out of Newtonian model. And it's disappointing because they are subtle energy techniques and we're looking for a cocktail party effect. Everybody knows a cocktail party effect. It's a loud, crowded room. Somebody whispers your name from the other side of it. They've immediately got your attention because you recognize not the strength of the signal, but the frequency of the signal. And this is something extremely important that I would emphasize to all of you, and hopefully you know this, is that in a biological system, outcome effect is not related to input volume or strength. It's related to the frequency signal. We have feedback loops inside of biological systems that either amplify or suppress specific frequencies. So we're not looking at a mechanistic system where more in means more out. Exactly the opposite. It's the frequency, and you can put in a tiny, tiny, tiny volume of scale if it's at the right frequency and trigger the system's natural feedback loops to get the result that you want. So again, we are talking about subtle energies, and what we're going to spend most of our time is here. This is a job to do, the same as for us. If you're sick, get healthy before you come back to work. Most of our time we want to be in dialogue with our landscape. What I'd like to do, because I don't know how much time we'll have, I just want to pick out some salient examples of each of these three categories, just to give you a sense of what is possible by fairy whispering. All right, so first we're going to look at this issue of taking off stress and hurt from a landscape. And this is a classic example. I'd also say this is one of my most dramatic examples, and I'm sharing it with you because this is what's possible. All right, we're looking at a sliding scale. Some landscapes are extremely stressed, some landscapes are slightly stressed, some landscapes really aren't stressed at all. So this would be at the extreme end of. So here we are, we're in a farm outside of Goondiwindi in New South Wales. And these guys actually had been doing regenerative agriculture for over 15 years already. They were doing high-density grazing, mob grazing, cell grazing. And they had radionics towers, three of them, already on farm. And they'd seen some results, but they hadn't really seen the results promised, all right? So they were already into the optimizations without doing the healing first. They had an opportunity to take a workshop with me, presenting this material to farmers so they can go home and apply it directly into their own landscape. But as I was local to them at the time, they brought me onto the farm. And sure enough, the farm was carrying what to a psychic eye was an incredibly heavy, thick fog of trauma from a massacre of Aboriginal indigenous people some decades before. And this included the presence of what we would call earthbound souls or ghosts involved. It included the stress and trauma of people who lived in that landscape for 40,000 years being forcibly displaced, and ethnocidal practices being applied, and everything that you can imagine would go with that. So that was sitting heavy on the landscape, and my job was first and primarily to heal that. And this is work that I've done all of my life. I'm a third generation psychic and healer. I trained in this with my parents and with other practitioners around the world, learning my arts. And so working with earthbound souls, working to clear the emotional residues associated, working to clear the curse pattern that had been applied, and other mental residues. And having done that, then making sure that the landscape intelligence understood the archetype of agriculture. Now that might seem a bit obvious to us, but again, remember, you're just a boat on the surface for an elemental. And if you've had a million years of growing kangaroos, and suddenly it's not wilderness anymore, but it's intensive monoculture, and with non-familiar species, European species of animals and plants, that the landscape doesn't necessarily have the barcode for, this is the communication level. And so we want to make sure that the elementals and the nature spirit consciousness understands that it's a farm, what farming is, and what plant and animal species are being requested of the elemental and nature spirits to support in the most optimum and healthy way. So, but basically this was a healing job, right? Because they already had their radionics towers, they were already doing cell grazing, they were already highly intentionally trained people. So 2 weeks after my work, they planted a sorghum crop, and as you can see from the result here, it came in, by my calculation, 44.5% higher than their best ever before yield. Even more exciting, perhaps, than that was that they turned out to be the only one of 10 local area farms served by the same agronomist who did not have to spray for a heliothis growth because their crop was so full of spiders and wasps that the heliothis was naturally predated. And they said when they finished harvesting, their combine harvester was literally covered in spiders' webs, and they were extremely excited about this, as you can imagine. So this is really primarily the result of healing the hurts in a landscape. And again, by my calculation, 44.5% higher than ever yield. I think what that means is that 30% of the growing potential of that landscape was locked up in this trauma pattern. 30% of the growing energy of the life. Now, I don't just work with farms, I work with any landscape, whether it's domestic or commercial or corporate, and we see the same kind of result. We often see a liberation of about 30% of potential when you really apply these techniques well. Consider other strategies that will give you a 30% increase and compare those. All right, so. Then I want to share a story that's really entirely about plant whispering, direct communication with the sentience of the plants themselves. And this happened just an hour and a half down the road here in Minchinhampton. And John and Melissa have given me permission to identify them. I don't identify clients generally unless they give me express permission. But in this case, we have this, and so we can directly quote results here. So, Woeful Dane is on the edge of the village that I live in Gloucestershire, and I have a very nice relationship with the farmers there. They like to have me work on the place, and they pay me in cheese. They're award-winning cheese farmers, and I would also mention that they won Best Farmer in Gloucestershire 2 years in a row after I started working with them first. And so the first thing we did here was, number one, was the healing of hurts. They had a mastitis problem. They'd been fined £1,000 for a high cell count from the people they supplied to the month before I started. We fixed up their geopathic stress and dropped their mastitis by 65% and got them down below 100 with their cell count from previously having been over 450. We increased their forage yield, increased their milk fat and protein, reduced calf mortality, and we also moved a poltergeist out of their milking parlour, which they were very happy about, which the cows were extremely relaxed about after that had gone. But this is the story that I want to share with here, because this is direct plant communication, and I definitely want to get you thinking about this. So, round about this time of year, in 2011, a little later, mid to late October, they had planted two, earlier in the year, they planted two large fields of alfalfa. And these were being held for their last green forage before shifting onto dry feed for the winter. And these fields were literally side by side, planted on the same day by the same equipment, by the same operation, with the same seed. Planted one, came through the gate, planted the other, job done. And these guys are strip grazing, and so they progressively grazed all the way through the first field with no trouble at all. But as soon as they moved onto the second field, in the first strip, they had seven cows bloat. And it's a small herd, and John is very attentive. He pulled the cows off the alfalfa and drenched them with vegetable oil, and that was a success. I believe he did not lose a cow, but now he was looking at an inedible field of what had been critical to his forage plan for the season. And so what do you think he did? He called his geobiologist. Obviously, when you have cows bloat, then you want to find the nearest geobiologist and have them have a good hard stare at the field and a chat with the plants. So that was my job to do. So fortunately, I was in the village and I came along and I sat down and I had a chat with the field. So what does that mean? It means that in my imagination, which is where we can communicate between species, I had what we would call a shamanic dialogue with the spirit of the farm and the spirit of the field and the spirit of the soil's biology and the soil itself and the spirit of the plants and the diva of the plants and the spirit of the cattle and the spirit of the herd and Saint Bridget, who is patron saint of cattle. And if you're in a jam and you need to pray, then you go upline as far as you can. So I'm inviting all of these intelligences, some of them with physical form and some of them with non-physical form, but all of them part of the collective intelligence of the space, at least as identified in my paradigm of working with this, which is basically the traditional European model, which, as I say, has given us sustainable agriculture for 6,500 years. So we had a good old chat, and there was great discord in the system. And for some reason, the plants, the alfalfa, had made itself indigestible to the cattle. Now, as you know, plants have both a primary and a secondary metabolic system. And their primary metabolites are what they need for everyday growth and life cycle. And then their secondary metabolites are their stress response to whatever's going on that they can't run away from. Our stress response is run away. Plant stress response has to be adapt, and so they've got a vast range of potential metabolites that they can create to make themselves unattractive, smell bad, indigestible. And I'm told that in South Africa there are acacia trees which giraffes have to graze from downwind, because as soon as the tree spots that it's being grazed, it instantly increases the level of tannins in its leaves, making itself unpalatable to the giraffe. Not only that individual tree, but the communication moves quickly through the entire grove of trees, and then the giraffes have to move on and creep up on the next ones surreptitiously and from downwind and get a nibble on that before the trees spot what's going on and again make themselves indigestible. So I believe that this is what had happened with the alfalfa, that they were not in the conversation that this was a crop that people had planted in order for animals to eat, in order for milk and cheese to be made, in order for that particular part of the life cycle to occur. The alfalfa was simply doing its own thing, stressed that it was being grazed on, and rendered itself indigestible to the cattle. So we had a chat about this, This happens in imagination, not as fantasy, but as clear telepathy, dropped down to the level of plant consciousness, which is the same as our digestive biology. We are also plant intelligence inside of us. So, frankly, telepathy, for those of you who are familiar with it, is incredibly fast. The thought transfers faster than you can speak it. Visual images download very powerfully and are often the most easy form of communication with both plants and animals. And so it took about 2 minutes for me to explain the situation and invite all vested parties to be cooperative to this farming system. And once everything had settled down, came into agreement, my job was done, I went away. And it turned out that after 12 hours had passed, John was able to put the cattle back onto the alfalfa and graze the whole of the rest of the field without any further bloat or adverse consequence to the animals. So, as you can imagine, there are more stories, but that's one of my best ones in terms of 2 minutes of dialogue with a field of alfalfa rendered it from something that was literally life-threatening to the cattle that were being grazed on it to something, again, that was nurturing, supportive, and vitalizing to that herd. So very exciting. And then optimizations. There are many optimizations. This is one that's familiar to many people. We used to call this a standing stone, and now we call it an emitter or a tower of power. Mm-hmm. And what we're looking at here, in fact, is a plastic pipe full of crushed basalt, which is especially high in paramagnetism, which allows the penetration of Schumann resonance, which is the atmospheric solar radiation, into the root zone, which stimulates plant life. And that work has been extensively researched by a gentleman called Phil Callahan, if you're interested in pursuing that aspect of it. This is secondarily being encased in clay tiles, mostly for aesthetic, but I think in fact that's added some strength to this particular tower. So this has been placed in a small biodynamic home garden patch, veggie garden patch, and its job is just to enhance this home garden. But by chance, the hedge line that we see immediately behind it accesses a pasture for cattle. And in that pasture for cattle, about 8 years before this shot was taken, because of a need for additional shade, they got a lorry load of trees from a nursery, all the same age, same species, and they planted them in two patches. With dowsing rods, at some point, they had explored how far this particular tower was throwing a beneficial effect. And they'd come up with a number, dowsing it out, walking it out in the field, about 450 yards. It so happened that half of the trees that they planted in this adjacent paddock were within that range of influence of this Schumann device, resonant device, power tower, and the other half had been planted outside of the reach of it. And so after 8 years of growth, this is the fence line that we were just looking at. So the tower is behind here. And these trees were outside of the reach of that thing. So just get a sense of the density and height of them, and then these trees are the ones within the range of that tower. And I think you can clearly see the difference in both height and vegetative density between these trees optimally affected on a farm that had already been cleared and balanced energetically, that this had significant effect. A similar tower in a grain situation was found in the first season after it had been placed, not only to give a 30% increase in the wheat crop. Notice how 30% shows up over and over again. You find that not only in human placebo, but also in what's being languaged as quantum agriculture. There's definitely a 30% margin, whether it's yield or health or increase, that is accessible to us easily in this fashion. So they got a 30% increase in wheat crop, but also, and apparently more valuable to them than the yield increase, was an increase in grade from the second and third grade of wheat to what they call premium hard, which is the most valuable grade of wheat on the market. As I say, that was even more beneficial to them than the yield increase. Do you think that these are beneficial to a farmer's economic bottom line in the season? These are non-toxic, zero-cost inputs, and we're looking at 30% yield increases. Show me anything else that's going to do that, that comes out of a bag, and I'll be impressed. All right. We don't want to just talk about plants. I want to just broaden our menu a little bit. How many of you have been involved in crocodile farming? All right, I can share with you the most exciting part about crocodile farming is gathering the eggs. And this is because this involves flying in a helicopter to a crocodile-infested river and then tossing a coin. And whoever loses the coin toss gets the egg basket and the trowel. All right, whoever wins the toss gets the rifle. Because the crocodiles lay their eggs like turtles do in mounds on the bank, and then they keep an eye on them. And the crocodile egg has an air pocket on the top, so it's not enough to just grab the egg and run. You've got to grab the egg, keep it exactly perfectly the right way up, and move as quickly as possible away from the mother and father. This makes the eggs incredibly valuable, as you can imagine, because it's very high risk, it's very expensive, and to get one of these, therefore, has a high level of cost to it. Now, one of the range of subtle energies, and we'll look at a menu of this in a moment, that's classically used is sound. Now, the old people told us that if you sang to your cattle, they would give you an increase in milk. How silly of us to forget that. How many researchers have played music to their cattle and increased their milk yield? Do we do it commercially? Do we take it seriously? How much do you think it costs to switch on the radio? All right. So what happened with the crocodiles? So the manager of this particular facility took both the level and one and two 3-day trainings with me, and then he went home to see what he could apply on his own farm out of the menu of quantum agricultural techniques that we've been discussing. And he decided to play music, specifically the sounds of Tibetan gongs and bowls, to his crocodile hatchery, to these eggs. And so he got himself an iPod and speakers, and he got himself a nice CD of what he believed were beneficial sounds, as they say, Tibetan gongs and bowls, traditional healing and life-enhancing sounds. Do you think it made a difference to them? If it didn't, I wouldn't be telling you about it. How much of a difference do we think it made? All right. So it increased the hatching rate from 70% to 87%. All right. I think 17 on 70 is net on net, 25% increase. This was worth $1.7 million per year to him. Now, before you can draw a bottom line, you have to take out the cost of the iPod and speakers. All right? Do you think he did it the second year around? Yeah. Do you think he worried if scientists thought that he was crazy or not? Do you think they put the money in the bank? All right. So quantum agriculture isn't just for fantasies in the bath. This is central to sustainable agriculture, and results are, as you can see, very substantial. To the extent that, frankly, not to use this would be questionable in intelligence and responsibility. Just a provocative thought. All right, so what do we mean by subtle energies? There are energies present within and around us but are beyond the range of our tangible senses. How many of us believe that things that we can't touch, taste, or see aren't real? All right, hopefully we're a more mature audience than that. Your cell phone is communicating with microwaves. But there's something else that communicates with microwaves that's inside us. Does anybody know what that is? It would be your mitochondrion. I think you'll find that the ADP to ATP bond is a microwave quantum. Which being true, if it is true, we're actually running our core metabolism on microwave. All right? But we consider it a subtle energy because it's imperceptible. So, subtle energies affect living systems depending on the quality and character of the energy. Remember we said that. It's the frequency, not the volume, that's significant. And the sensitivity of the system to that particular input. Is it your name that's been whispered on the other side of the cocktail party or not? Now we have a vast traditional terminology for subtle energy which goes by every culture. It's our animating life force, it's our ether, our chi, our prana. Num is what the CAWR bush people call it. Ode and organ have come from a European tradition. And now to add to the list we have Ormus. My mother, who spent a lifetime working with this material, once quietly over a whiskey smiled and said, I wonder how many terms they'll come up with for love. Anyway, these are traditional terms for life force, and these are our contemporary terms for the same thing. So we have five, we can extend it, but five key subtle energy terms we're allowed now: electricity, magnetism, gravity, weak and strong nuclear forces. We need not think that these are different from these. We're all looking at the same stuff, right? So we are bioelectromagnetic beings. Our life energy is electromagnetism. Every chemical interaction in your body is bioelectrochemical. It's plus and minus coming together or splitting apart. So our electrochemistry, our bioelectricity, is in fact our chi. We're not looking for chi to be something other than what we're already working with. Everybody's interested in life energies, whatever tradition. And so we want to just remember that information guiding principles and especially practical applications being gathered from both traditional and contemporary sources. And I would emphasize in fact that there is vastly more traditional wealth and knowledge base in the traditional sources than in the contemporary ones, because we are on the edge of exploring, let alone understanding, quantum. But we have had hundreds of thousands of years of working with this material under another language system. But because we don't recognize what they were talking about, we discard the wisdom of observation and experience developed over thousands of years. And we think we're frightfully clever with what we do. But not until you get an extra 30% on your potato yield. Then you're clever. So subtle energies in landscape, what can we use? There's this hugely wide range and menu of things that we can apply. I would place above all other things human love. And we do not consider love in this regard to be the romantic kind of love. We are talking about the love that is God love, that is goddess love, that is the thing that creates and holds the world together. This is not soft option, this is extreme mother bear love, the kind of love that brings us to the edge of compassion, sometimes beyond the edge of compassion. So human love is rocket fuel for every living system of every kind, whether it's human, animal, plant, elemental. And that alone applied often will give us our 30% yields. If you love up one set of seeds in a tray germinating on the kitchen table and love up the water that you're watering with and ignore the other set of seeds in a separate tray and simply give it water that hasn't received love, again, we find that magical 30% showing up in terms of dry seed mass after 10 to 14 days. Not ever to be confused with human love, but necessary for clarity and communication then is our intention. Our intention to farm, our intention to farm particular crops, our intention to have pest-free crops, to have beneficial harvests, our intention to have healthy animals and healthy land. So human love and human intention go together, but love has to come first, creates the rapport and bond, and then the intention is the communication that happens into that space of love, trust, mutual respect, and rapport that the love has developed. Beyond that, and I would say again, into the category of optimizations, we have sound, as mentioned, geomagnetism, what's the level of paramagnetism in your soil? Is it supporting terrestrial magnetism appropriate for plants? Is it allowing Schumann resonance to penetrate into the root zone? Biodynamic preparations, many of us are familiar with and using classical homeopathy, a vast materia medica for applications into every part of landscape work. Radionics, where we're remotely broadcasting frequencies and intentions. There's a longer list than this, but these ones are a good starting block and are perhaps the most familiar and the most commonly practiced contemporarily. Now, just a little quick bit of background physics, because we don't want anybody to think that fairy whispering is without its substantive science. I believe there is no difference between physics and metaphysics. And one of the aphorisms of the magical community is as above, so below, meaning if it doesn't work in the 3D world, it isn't going to work in the 4D either. So we're not looking for a different science, we're not looking for a different energy, we're not looking for something outside the box. We're looking for the observer effects, we're looking for the intelligence surrounding the physical form, and we're working with that directly. Now, as you mostly probably know, there is only one self-sustaining field form known in the universe, and that is a toroidal field, which you see before you now. If you aren't one of these, you can't hold yourself together, literally. How many of us off camera have ever managed to blow smoke rings? All right. So what's the fascination of that? It's an independent entity all by itself, and it retains its identity for as long as it maintains rotational symmetry. When it loses rotational symmetry, it disperses literally into a cloud of gas. This is also true of you, and of me, and of the planet, and the solar system, and of a wheat stalk, and of a cow. This is the image of God, and we are all made in God's image. Now, this is significant because, as I said before, healing strategies that work in a person also work in a plant and an animal and a landscape. This is because we all are identical fields. We vary in scale through fractality, but if you're not one of these, you're not anything at all except a dispersed cloud of gas. I'm not making this part up, honestly. You can check that. So the toroidal field is generated by as you can see here, a system that has a dualistic potential, and it applies to the magnetic field that holds the Earth together, and it applies to the electromagnetic field created and recreated every time your heart beats. We live in an electromagnetic toroidal bubble generated literally every second, renewed by the beating of your heart. So we are entirely fractal to planet in this regard. We're fractal to walnut, we're fractal to apple, and within that donut, within that resonant bubble, we then capture and enhance, like a radio, whatever frequencies capture our attention. We're back to whether it's what you hold in your mind. Is it more important what you put in your mind? Is it more important the food you put in your body? We're just considering this. So the Earth has its bubble, and then the impact of the solar wind here, as you can see, sets up what are called micropulsations. These are resonances. The solar wind beats on the edge of the ionosphere like a hand on a drum, and creates a full spectrum of resonances, the peak of which is a so-called Schumann resonance at 7.83 cycles per second, but there's a full spectrum of natural resonances created inside of this envelope. These frequencies are significant because everything that's evolved on the planet has evolved to these frequencies. And the highest peak of atmospheric resonance, as I say, is 7.83 cycles per second hertz, which turns out to be the exact midpoint of the four octaves of our brain function. That lies exactly at the midpoint between the alpha and the theta consciousness. So we are literally attuned to our planet. I want to just make the point here that a wave traveling through time and space captured within the toroid becomes a circular wave. So there's no difference between the circle and the wave that it creates, except the circle is held in its frequency within your bubble, and then the wave is released, or the wave is captured and then amplified through circular resonance. So any wave passing through time and space we can capture in our bubble or in any toroidal field and amplify and hold that and then let it go. So we need to see an equivalence between the circular wave patterns in the toroid and the waves that then progress through time and space, just like that. Now, different frequencies relate to different levels of consciousness. And we've known this for hundreds and thousands of years. This is our map of consciousness. This is Robert Flood from the 1600s. And here at the bottom of our string length, we've got earth, water, air, fire. That's our elemental range of frequencies. Then here we have our emotions and our thoughts and our higher consciousness. That's a human being. Then we have our angelic realms, our archangelic realms. And then these realms are our powers and mights and thrones and cherubim. And this is beyond the ordinary reach of human consciousness without facilitation, whether that's extreme fasting or entheogenic plants. This is somewhat within our dreamscape. This is our normal waking consciousness. And again, as I say, the elemental and nature spirit consciousness, therefore, is within our frequency range. The electromagnetic spectrum, as we know, is infinite. Our thoughts are down here on the same spectrum, all right? So what's the difference between sunlight and human thought? Only frequency. Only frequency. Do plants relate to sunlight? There it is. 5 × 10⁶ waves per second. Human thought, we've been talking about, from 1 to 30 cycles per second. These are long, slow waves compared to sunlight and microwave, but there is no difference, except for frequency and waveform, between sunlight and microwave and radio and x-ray and human thought and feeling. So we are unavoidably communicating all of the time throughout our electromagnetic environment. Do you think the wave of your thought stops at the edge of your skull? Doesn't seem to. Doesn't stop radio, doesn't stop microwave, we know that, heats your brain up, your thoughts are coming out, your thoughts are coming in, all right? We are unavoidably sharing literally the collective field of our electromagnetically generated thoughts and feelings, and they're very specific. These are whole numbers to make it easy. 30 to 14 is this awake normal consciousness. This is the part that plants and animals can't get into so easily. They're not working up here so much. Phil Callahan showed plants going up to 24 cycles per second, which actually is quite well up to that, but I would put plant consciousness easily in here, in our alpha state. And that's naturally where you go when you're gardening, isn't it? You drop into that lucid, not thinking, relaxed, intuitive space. Deeper than that, our meditative space. This is where I went to talk to the field of alfalfa because I wanted to include the gnomes, the elementals, the soil biology, which is going to be a lower frequency. 8, it says here, this is actually the Schumann resonance is here, the midpoint, 7.83, down here into delta, we're more into mineral consciousness, and so forth. So understand that from neuroelectric therapy, we understand that 72 cycles per second will alleviate the human body from heroin addiction, and 90 cycles per second will do the same for cocaine. So those plants are generating very specific frequencies in our brain, which we can reproduce artificially, but that we can reproduce them artificially lets us know that that level of consciousness is specific both to that frequency and to the waveform, all right? So it's not frequency alone that we're working with, it's waveform, all right? So we frequency modulate, FM, and we also amplitude modulate, AM. That's how we communicate content through a carrier wave. So here we can see the difference in wave shapes compared between different human emotions. So this gets very, very specific. So when we're talking about telepathic communication, we're talking as specific as the communication that happens with your cell phone, modulated through microwave with a carrier signal that's both frequency and amplitude modulated and reinterpreted at the other end and comes out as sound. So in a way, telepathic communication with the plant is identical to talking on a cell phone, just a slightly different frequency set. There's no difference between your thoughts and a microwave except for frequency and waveform. Now, I'm guessing that a lot of you have seen these pictures made by Dr. Emoto. These show how water absorbs thought and feeling in very dramatic effect. This is a low temperature photography effect where water is photographed just as it emerges into liquid crystal form from a fully frozen state. And just for those of you too far back in the room to read this, it says the photo on the left is of an ice crystal frozen from severely polluted water. The photo on the right is the same water refrozen after having been blessed. All right. How many of you can bless water? You just add your own love. That's what a blessing is. A blessing is a transfer of unconditional love without intention. Unconditional love without intention is a blessing. And it does that to water. Do you think that would make any difference to your plants? The answer is 30%, all right? The answer to all of this is 30%. Okay, do you think it would make any difference to fertility and weight gain in stock? It does. Here we go, same ones we saw. We see gratitude here, we see hatred, we see love and appreciation. Notice, we're not impressed by the hexagonality of it. It has to be hexagonal, it's water. What we're looking at is the level of coherence that occurs with higher human emotion. If you're playing music to your cows, just be careful what music you play to them. All right. It seems they like jazz. Now, I want to just share a little bit more about water, and then we'll probably stop and take questions. But I've been talking about elemental consciousness, and I've shared with you a story about plants changing themselves. So what these pictures show us is that we can imprint our thoughts and feelings onto elemental consciousness. What I want to leave you clearly appraised of is that elemental consciousness is interactive. It's not just passive. All right? Now let me ask, how many of you think that water can move outside of gravity? Hard one. They didn't teach me that in high school. They also didn't mention it in medical school. They didn't mention anything quantum in medical school. We had the Heisenberg effect shown in the 1950s, and we're still, 60 years later, thinking and operating in all of our systems as though it doesn't exist. That's kind of curious, actually. So I want to just appraise you that elementals are interactive and that water can do things other than follow gravity. All right, so we have a tradition in this country and all around the world of blessing our wells and springs on an annual basis. We still have a vestigial practice of that in the North Country, around Bakewell and other areas, of garlanding of flowers, a festival of singing to the water. Does it make any difference? Well, we've seen those photographs, so we assume that it increases coherence. And increased coherence can make quite a big difference. So here's a well that's getting thoroughly blessed in, we're back in New South Wales. And with mob grazing and moving pastures every day, this particular farm had 120 pastures. Sheep were moved every day. Approximately half of the pastures were watered into troughs from a single central borehole, and the other half of the pastures were watered with shallow ponds. And the farmer on the farm did share that the sheep generally showed a slight preference, not huge, but a slight preference for the trough water, he assumed, because it was slightly cleaner and fresher. So we had a field day with 30 Australian farmers, and we talked metaphysics in the morning, and we went out looking for things to bless in the afternoon, as one does, if one's into quantum agriculture. And we blessed a field that he was concerned had a very low mycorrhizal count, and an assay taken 10 days later showed that the mycorrhizal count had gone off the chart. We then blessed the well, and 2 days later I get a call from Matt. He says, "Patrick, I've never seen this before, but the sheep have changed their behavior. And now when I open the gate to let them out of a pond field into a trough field," sorry, two weeks had gone by. He'd been moving them daily for 2 weeks. Says, "Feedback after 2 weeks, when I let them out of a pond field into a trough field, the mob now gallops up to 1.2 k's straight to the trough." Now this continued consistently for 6 months until I got back to the farm. All right, get back to the farm. What are we gonna do next? Let's bless the ponds. So we bless all the ponds. Instantly the sheep go back to, they don't care whether it's pond water or trough water. All right. Now, that's not the end of the story. That, I think, is easily understood in terms of if you bless water, you're making it more coherent, it makes it more palatable, it makes it more good for the sheep. We're impressed with that, and often in agriculture, frankly, blessing your water properly is one of the highest leverage things you can do, because what takes water? Everything. All right? So it's kind of a universal. It's one of the universals. So I want to tell you, though, that one of the jobs that people like me have is dowsing for wells. And we get asked to locate for boreholes, deep ones, shallow ones. And we had a bad drought about 15 years ago in Vermont, and all of the drillers and all of the dowsers got very busy because many of the shallow springs went dry and people were needing to drill deeper into the lower aquiferic layers to get water. And a friend of mine asked me to come and look at her spring, which was up behind her house in the woods. It was only 3 feet deep, shallow spring in the woods, and it had held out for all the 20 years she'd been there, and this drought had gone dry. So she asked me to come and have a look, and a bit like whispering with the alfalfa, right? It's just you and your mind and the intelligence surrounding you. And so it happens in here. It's not unreal, it is the imaginal reality, which is the reality we've been cheated from understanding for reasons of power and control. Now, so I spoke to the spirit of her spring, right? And it was still there, even though the water wasn't. And I explained to it, through my imagination, that the people would like the water back because that was the source of water for this property. And I asked if the spring could bring the water back, and it said yes. And I asked if it would bring the water back, and it said yes. And I asked if it needed anything from the human side to support this, and it said, "Could you sing to me, please?" All right. There's nobody around. I'm in the middle of the woods with just a couple of mates who know I'm weird, and who are weird enough too. So we all sing to this spring. All right, what do you think happens? I'll tell you what happens. Within 48 hours, this thing is filled back up with water in the absence of a rain event. That's a little strange. And then, about 10 days later, I had an opportunity to do the same again on another one, and that worked. And then, shortly after that, I was doing a completely different piece of work for another client. And when we were having a cup of tea after I'd finished my job, she said, "By the way, I haven't told anybody this, but my spring went dry and I sang to it and it came back to life." So now it doesn't look so stupid that we go and bless our springs in Wales every year, does it? All right. Is the water table dropping in any parts of the country, in any parts of the world we're aware of? Do you think we're still blessing our springs? Do you think it makes a difference? So here, I've got photographs for you. We're back in New South Wales, where I have done a lot of this work, and which is a semi-arid landscape. Now, the Aboriginal communities both lived and moved along waterways in the Australian landscape. And so we're going back now to the beginning of the healing of hurts. Often, the residual energy of Indigenous people's displacement is along the waterways in Australia. And so this farm had some of this, and Colin and I went and we visited, and we healed and blessed everything we possibly could, and we let the place know it was a farm, and we spoke to the elementals, inviting them to support the farming operation in the best way that they could. We're looking at a creek bed here that had been dry for 8 years. All right. 2 weeks later, in the absence of rain, it looked like that. All right, here's the biggest piece of news though. This was only running on their property. It was still dry on the neighbour's property upstream. So I think what's happened here is that in the Australian landscape, the water isn't necessarily gone away, it's gone down into the gravel beds beneath the waterways. And it would seem that, against the laws of physics and gravity as we know them, this water rose, but only on their farm, not on the neighbouring property. Only where we'd healed and blessed this did this water come back to life. And so I think I'll close the presentation there with that as a lingering memory, just to emphasise we really are talking about a dialogue between elemental consciousness, which includes working with weather, by the way, as well as with water, as well as with the soil's biology, the earth, as well as that geomagnetism and Schumann resonance, perhaps the terrestrial fire. But these are interactive. The elementals can support us if they are healthy and clear from stress, and if we communicate with them clearly through in their own way, in their own language, which is the telepathic communication of waveform and frequency. And we can drop our mind to or include in our grace state, in our global state of coherence, the level of consciousness that is that of cow or wheat or mycorrhizal fungus or water or air. And honestly, the most humbling thing, and perhaps the final message that I would like to convey to you, is that the elementals and nature spirits appear to be unfathomably generous and patient with us. And we seem to have a sacred relationship here on the planet, not one of being damaging and toxic and planet better off if people weren't here, quite the opposite. The results that I've been sharing with you to me assert that human beings are held sacred, and our lives and our needs and our purposes are supported by our natural landscape, by the intelligence in our environment, by the elemental nature spirit consciousness, if we will only enter into the traditional husbandry, marriage relationship with our landscape, fill the space between ourselves and our farms, our crops, our animals with unconditional love, express on that carrier wave our needs and clear intentions so that they can support and refine and define where they place their life energy into the into processes that include those which are most beneficial to us.